Well, Ventura, welcome to Get Moving TV. Our show is really, it's about Ventura, it's about the area. As you know, Eddie Tadouri with the Rhythmic Arts Project is dear to my heart. Go to fundraisers all the time, and there's always some fantastic photographs. I know Eddie is a heck of a photographer. And so met this man who was taking some pretty nice pictures. I think we shook hands once or twice and wasn't sure if he knew how to talk because we just shook hands. So with me today is David Palmer. So we won't shake hands today. It's time to talk. So how did you get to meet Eddie? And then we'll talk about how you came to where you are.
Okay. I've known Eddie for 5 million years, and that's give or take a few.
Yeah.
We were in rock and roll bands together back in the late 70s, early 80s, and we were just close, and we were tight friends, and came up in the LA music scene, kind of. We didn't know each other, but we came up in that scene, and then I lost track of him. I lost track of him, and I got a call from a friend of mine in Portland, Oregon, and she said, I'm going to send you a newspaper, The Oregonian, and I want you to take a look at this. I said, great, you know, somebody had written an article about something. And it's about Eddie and Eddie's involvement with the Rhythmic Arts Project and what he's been doing. And I had lost track for 10 years. So we got back together again, and I was astonished. Not only in the change in myself, but the extraordinary change in him, you know. Musicians are notoriously self-centered. I mean, we think about nothing but ourselves. And Eddie had changed from this guy who fit that profile to a guy who was loving and caring and had this incredible organization called the Rhythmic Arts Project. And he was putting on benefits. And I said, boy, I'd love to come up and photograph that stuff because I've changed my vocation too. I'm now a photographer. He said, let's do it. And that's how we reconnected.
I think that is, you got Eddie to a T with let's do it, because that's he's reopened everybody's efforts there. Well, we were talking earlier about my musical career starting just tapping a ruler in the back of a recording session. And
a famous recording session. You didn't say that.
You have a famous recording session there. So when did you start? So rock and roll band, so high school,
yeah,
looking for the girls.
I was not a great student. I wasn't a great athlete. But when the Beatles and the Stones came over in 65 and 66, I found my calling. And I had a good voice, and I was a singer, and I became a singer in various local bands and back in Watchung, New Jersey, and I just loved music. It became my life. It's all, it became all I was interested. Plus, it was a great way to get girls. I mean, let's face it, if you're not a jock and you're not brilliant, being in music is a great thing. And I went to New York when I was about 18. I was in Greenwich Village, and it was a great time and a great place, but I could never make it in Boston, in New York, in the Village, so I started to move around the East Coast a lot with various bands. I went to Philadelphia, I ended up going to college in Boston in a little liberal arts college called Emerson College, which is now taken over the city of Boston, but at the time was just a small college. And around 1972, I got a call from a group that was forming in Los Angeles, and they had heard my voice, they had heard some records I'd made that had gone nowhere, and they asked me if I'd like to come out and join. And I had no pressing engagements at the time. You know, I was just next to destitute. So I got my car and came across country with just, you know, I figured if I didn't fit in with the band, I could get a job doing something, you know, working at whatever was fashionable at the time. So I got in that car, came across country, came into LA in 1972 in July, at a recording studio called Village Recorders in Santa Monica, which is still there. And the group that was forming was a group called Steely Dan. And I joined the group. I was the first original member of Steely Dan. And we came up with our first record. I sang a song called I'm a Fool to Do Your Dirty Work, which just got picked up for American Hustle. It was just in the movie. And I sang with the group, and it was yeah, a dream come true. It was not a group that toured much. We stayed home a lot at that point in time. And I was in about a year and a half, 2 years, and they decided that they didn't need my help anymore. And they asked me to leave the group because Donald Fagen wanted to sing all the vocals, which is what he should have done in the first place. The reason I was hired is because he was petrified to go on stage. And I had no problem with that. I loved, you know, again, a musician, self-centered. I loved to be the spotlight. And it's funny though, I got stage fright later on, but that's for another story. But I was the front man for a while. And then when Donald said, look, enough, I want to sing my own songs, I knew the writing was on the wall. So I left Steely and left, that's a euphemistic way. I was asked to leave. And I had a friend out in Los Angeles who I had known for years, a woman named Carol King. And Carol found out I was no longer with Steely Dan. She called me, she said, look, I'm doing an album. Would you like to write lyrics? Because she knew I could write a lyric or two. And she called me and we got together, we started to write, and out of that collaboration came a song called Jazz Man, which was very successful in the 70s. And so my career in the music business continued for another 20, 25 years. Very successful, and you know, it was very gratifying in a lot of ways. But then I woke up one day and realized I hated the music business. I hated it, and I had no longer a place in it. I was like 45 years old. And I didn't have any passion for it anymore, and it was out of my life. So I got lucky in terms of the arts. So.
Well, I remember talking with Eddie, but maybe it's an apocryphal story since he's in the audience here. Mm-hmm. Hearing from the neurosurgeon, oh, you're never going to play the drums again. And his first thought is, I don't have to hustle for another gig.
Yeah, well, so, that was kind of weird. Yeah. It's a funny, strange sense of relief that you don't have to do that anymore. But it was partially that, but it was also just, what am I going to do? You know. Yeah. And at the age of about 50, I picked up a camera. I thought, wow, I really like this. You know, first of all, I don't have to make a group decision when I take my camera out. I don't have to ask four other guys if they think it's okay. You know, I don't have to get a lot of opinions, and I like the creative process. And now a lot of people say, well, how is it to shoot film? I will tell you right now, I have never shot film. I was of the digital age. I picked up a digital camera and that was it, and off and running. And then I started to realize that I just didn't want to be a photographer. I didn't want to be doing a lot of weddings. You know, first of all, it's real strenuous, and second of all, I have an ego myself. I don't need more egos involved. So I started just to shoot on my own, and I developed a style. So I'm very happy with what I do now.
So when we talk about style, you did no formal training, but you developed something that's become the David Palmer style. Is it aperture, lighting?
It's basically what I do. There's a past master at this stuff, a guy named Joel Grimes, who does the kind of photography I got interested in. And basically what it is compositing. I shoot backgrounds that I love all over the country, and then I shoot people in my studio. And it's a three light setup. And the reason it's a three light setup is you have a what they call a key light, and then they have two rim lights. And the reason you do that is so that when you composite someone into a scene, you can never tell where the sun's coming from, okay? So it gives you a choice of where you want to emphasize light. And I saw the way he did it, and I loved the way he did it. But I wanted to do something more. I wanted to tell stories with this kind of photography. And so I tried to figure out how to do that and what I wanted to do. And there are three examples I can give you. Back in the late 60s, early 70s, there was a great songwriter, singer named Gram Parsons, who anybody older than 25 is going to go, who? Anyway, he was a terrific influence on bringing country and rock and roll together. He wrote a song called Grievous Angel, which I love the song. And he died in Joshua Tree. It's a very sketchy story about how he died and what he did, and that doesn't matter. But what I did was I thought to myself, God, I would love to sort of emulate that in a photograph. So I went to Joshua Tree and shot all these incredible backgrounds, and then I put an actual woman dressed as an angel into the scene. Now it sounds kind of sophomoric in a way, but when I got done, I realized I had something very special with this. So that was one thing I did. Then I'd heard there was a place down in Salton Sea, a mountain that someone had built down there called Salvation Mountain. I thought to myself, God, I've never heard of this place. I want to go check it out. So I went to Southern California, Salton Sea, and I saw this incredible structure. It's folk art, is what it is. This guy, it's iconic as the Watchtower, as far as I'm concerned. And what this guy had done is he built all this stuff with concrete and put all these religious symbols and God loves you and incredible biblical sayings all over this mountain. I thought, that's great. But what had happened to it, the concrete had broken in the heat and whatever had gone. So he had to redo the whole thing. We're talking about an incredible mountain. So he finished it up, and it's still there. And I shot this, and I thought to myself, God, I got to put somebody into this. I'm not quite sure who. I have a friend. This is, by the way, one of the pictures of this series. I have a friend named Jeff Kober. For all you Walking Dead fans, Jeff was on the last year of Walking Dead. He always plays maniacs. He's always playing guys who are one card short of a full deck. And that's who he plays on television. He was also in China Beach. He did a lot of great stuff. And I said, Jeff, I need a maniac for my shot. I want an ambivalent maniac. I don't want somebody who's tearing up the scenery, but I want someone who, and he has that look. So I said, the funny thing about Jeff, he's also my meditation teacher. He's one of the most peaceful guys I've ever met. He's very, very, very spiritual and very, very sweet, but he always plays these characters on shows. So I got Jeff to pose. This is Jeff playing sort of a loose cannon pastor kind of guy. And if you look in his eyes, you don't know if he's totally insane or totally spiritual or where he's going with his look. So that's one of the stories I told. There's a six cell series in this thing. And I've also shot New York. I recently did a New York stories, and it's the same thing. I'm interested in stories. I'm interested in seeing how people are looking. Not so much, it doesn't have to be the same model. It doesn't have to be, it just has to be something a little off. And I managed to do that with most of my pictures. So anyway, that's my art now. I'm basically compositing, but I call the series Romantic Realism. And my website is davidpalmerimages.com. There's a plug, davidpalmerimages.com. And it has not only my composites, but also my portraiture on it and landscape.
So if I go to that website, do I get prints? I get buttons, hats,
you
frisbees?
If you get a hat, please call me and tell me how you did that. Actually, you go out to another website. It's, if you want to buy, it says right there. You go to another website, and they're available different sizes, different prices. You know, I really didn't want to get into the merchandising part of that. But there's a site that will do that for you. Plus, I have a manager now who's more than willing to sell my services to the highest bidder. Thank you, God. You know, I've got somebody. And also, my music's on there. I have some of the stuff's never been released is on that website. If you're interested in listening to what it was like back in the day, you know. So that's my music scene. Yeah.
I'm always fascinated by names in the 60s and 70s. So what were the names of some of your first groups? And then we'll circle around on digital rights.
Well, I had a group called the King Bees. That was my first group because it was based on an old Elmore James song called I'm a King Bee. And we were going to go with that name. And then there was a group in New York who had already copyrighted the name. And that group, oddly enough, is a group that it's a long story, but I ended up playing with that group in Greenwich Village in a place called the Night Owl Cafe. And it was run by a guy named Danny Cooch. Danny Kochmeyer.
Yeah.
Danny Cooch later on became a guitar player with various groups, including with Carol and several others. But the singer in that group that we were opening for was a guy named James Taylor. And the group was called The Flying Machine. And James later alluded to that in a lyric about sweet dreams and flying machines and pieces on the ground. And that's what he was talking about. But we had a group called the King Bees, and they had copyrighted the name, so we couldn't use it. Then we became the Middle Class, with a Y, because we were all middle class kids. And that was managed by a guy named Al Aronowitz, who was a great reporter, rock and roll reporter, and a great rock critic for the New York Post for years. And very involved with Dylan and the Beatles and all that scene. So he was our manager. But that was the Middle Class. We stuck with that for a while. I don't know. And that seemed to work.
Well, just getting back to the music and the like, we're in a new era. I mean, it's all Spotify, Pandora,
yes.
Apple, whatever.
Yeah.
So did you have the foresight to try and protect yourself way back when?
I was lucky enough. Digital royalties became doable for groups that occurred after 1972. and I was in 1972, the class of 72, the first Steely Dan record. But the problem with all that is that I had, my royalties were good, still are, with both Carol and Steely. I don't know who buys those records, but whoever you are, thank you very much. It's not records anymore, it's CDs. But somebody keeps buying that stuff and it keeps selling and it's great, and which is terrific. However, I was about 5-6 years ago, I was called by someone. They said, you know, are you getting paid on digital royalties? Back in the day, you got paid, and I don't want to bore anybody with this, but no. You got paid with, your royalties came from writing, so you got your writing and publishing, or from record sales, and that was it. That was your royalty stream. But since Spotify, Cirrus, all these new things came into being, you also get now paid on digital performances. So every time there's a record, Steely Dan reeling in the ears gets played on the radio, I get a billionth of a cent. You know? And if you multiply that by Spotify and everything, it adds up. But I was not aware of that digital royalty stream until someone called me and said, are you aware of this? And I said, no. I said, well, what do I do? And he said, well, if I were you, I'd go and ask their accountants. So make a long story even longer. I did ask, and they said, well, we're sorry you didn't say anything a few years ago, so you know, you're out of luck. I said, I don't think I am. And I went back, and a lawsuit occurred. Mm-hmm. I didn't want to be, it's very funny. The lawyer that I hired said, look, a very prestigious firm in Los Angeles. He said, I'm going to tell you right now, this is going to hit TMZ. It's going to hit all the papers. And I said, who cares about a rock and roll group in the 70s being sued, you know? He said, you're going to be shocked. And he was absolutely right. It hit the papers. And it was like, this guy's suing Steel, you know, he's been steel-eyed or something. I don't know what some terrible TMZ comment. And it hit the papers, and they were not happy. And I was not happy. I didn't want publicity. I just wanted, as I told somebody, I said, I don't want their money, I want my money. So what happened was, eventually things got settled, and there's a whole new royalty stream now, for which I am very grateful. But you're right, the digital performances opened everything up.
You know? Well, and I think it kept that song American Hustle out as a CD.
Yes, it did. That's a whole backstory that I really don't want to get into, but they managed to really screw it up. And I said, I was just grateful that, you know, people went to the theater and called me and said, hey, you'll never guess. And they put, you know, they couldn't have picked a better place to put that song. It's in the title of the movie. I was like, whoa, okay. So, you know, I'm very grateful. I've had a great life. I've had a great career in music. I love my photography. You know, I'm very fortunate that I've been able to work as an artist all these years in some way, shape, or form, you know, because a lot of guys haven't, you know. And it keeps me centered in a way that that other things may not. It makes me available to people like Eddie for what he's doing and his great work. And I'm involved with another project, another charity in Los Angeles called We Spark, which is a cancer deal, and I shoot there. I try to give back the way I can give back. Sometimes through money and sometimes just contributing my services. I mean, much like you would do, you know, in what you do, so.
Well, David, thanks so much for joining us. The whole fame thing, how have you dealt with that? Just to kind of...
Well, first of all, I'm not that famous, which is really a good thing, you know. I mean, I've had musicians know who I am, yeah. And guys who, you know, but I've been very lucky in a sense. You know, I'm still close to Carol, and we don't talk a whole lot, but, you know, the fame that she had was so overwhelming after Tapestry. I can't imagine being having that inflicted on you, because he had no life. It was, you know, and since in the past few years, she's become kind of, not a recluse, but she's certainly sticking to herself, you know, in private. And I admire her for that, and I didn't have that kind of fame, so I'm okay.
All right. Well, David, thank you so much for joining us.
Somebody. cause your man is out of town. That's the time you get me running, and you know I'll be around.
I'm a fool to do your dirty work, oh yeah. I don't wanna do your dirty work no more. I'm a fool to do your dirty work, oh yeah.
Light the candle, put the lock upon the door. You have sent the maid home early, like a thousand times before. Like the castle in its corner, in a medieval game, I foresee terrible trouble, and I stay here just the same.
I'm a fool to do your dirty work, oh yeah. I don't wanna do your dirty work no more. I'm a fool to do your dirty work, oh yeah.